Hotel is a story about our situation as a Scrum Master community in Inclusion Gaming, and about how we changed our perspective on Agile and our role in the organization. We started out with, let's say, a classic Agile transformation. We have a kind of reporting on all our work coming from Jira, and out of this reporting, we try to analyze how the data is, let's say, produced, how the data is produced as a result of our processes, our people, and our products. Still, we read this, let's say, from left to right. We look at the reports, then we think, hey, what has happened? But of course, it is the process of people and products that are causing the results that we see in data. Okay, Agile transformation. Who is familiar with Scrum? Okay. That's about half of you. Scrum is a kind of organization out of the box, a software development organization out of the box. It defines a couple of roles, it defines a couple of artifacts, a couple of events, and together you can take it, well, as I said, out of the box, fill in a couple of people, fill in your data on what you want to develop, and start developing software straight away. The Scrum framework thinks at the level of teams, which is relatively small. Now, if we want to do something bigger, we need an organization that can work at this bigger scale. And like a good number of others, our idea was that we should learn this from Spotify. We have the product owner that comes from Scrum, we have teams, we are called squads, similarly from Scrum, and we work with guilds, meaning, for instance, people who are all developing in JavaScript. Now, looking differently at the organization, the teams are back here in green. Above the teams, product owners. Every team is one product owner. Under teams, servant leaders, Scrum Masters. One Scrum Master working for two teams. Scrum Masters are working together in a Scrum Master community of practice. That's the little block with SNC below. Product owners are working with the director of products, who is responsible for our roadmap, for our portfolio. If you look at the top half of this diagram, then you see this relation of teams going to roadmaps through product owners. Which means that product owners have a, let's say, role between thinking in terms of our final product and the work that is done in teams. They have responsibility. Now, looking at the bottom half of this little organizational diagram, we see Scrum Masters who are working together as a Scrum Master community or a Scrum Master community of practice, but they are dissociated from this roadmap. That has an effect. I will get back to the effect of that later. As for teams, we are striving to have self-organizing teams. Thinking back of the Agile Manifesto, we built our projects around motivated individuals. Give them the environment and support they need, and trust them to get the job done. So, as a Scrum Master, we stimulate teams to be self-organizing. Good. Now, why would we do this? We want to give control to those who know best. Control over making decisions about how to work. And once people have control, they have more motivation. Because when you're responsible, you feel more motivated to get to a result. Now, when we put all this together, this self-organizing nature of teams, teams being allowed to define their own work processes, we got to something like this. That really looked out as a team working in its own ways. Growing over time, they found what worked best for them. So after starting out with our ID, we have Scrum, and we have a matrix organization, and together this scales to one model. In practice, we got to something like at the left top, relatively routine work on products that are already existing, but with several teams working on the same product. Several teams with one product on their own. They're working with Scrum, and they do their estimations in story points. Another team on the right is really working on innovative products. Scrum again, but now with estimations in ideal days. Furthermore, all estimations are done in subtasks in Jira. Now, how is this relevant? Well, subtasks are not supported so well by all the reporting done in Jira. And the team has no Scrum Master. What happened? Basically, they said, we're self-organizing. Thank you for being interested in working with us, but Scrum Master, we can do without you. Different teams and different structures. We have component teams, Scrum bound estimations and days, a size of 14 developers, which is way larger than the ideal size of a team as you do it in Scrum. We have teams that are working only on defects, using Kanban, no estimations at all. So we drifted, let's say, apart. It was no longer possible to make sense of what different teams were doing. They could not be compared anymore. If you wanted to find something out about how a team is doing, how they are progressing, you have to ask somebody. And you can get an answer, maybe immediately, maybe in several days. Now, all this led to a crisis. So several teams opted to work without a Scrum Master. And in total, within the evolution, the number of Scrum Masters dwindled. Generally, our agile transformation direction was lost. Management was, I say here, agnostic. They had no opinion on whether to do this or do that. Now, this was, let's say, a crisis that Scrum Masters felt very much. But what made it worse is that the rest of the organization didn't experience this as a crisis. They said, what crisis? We are doing fine. Which means that the position of the rest of Scrum Masters is such that they feel maybe we are redundant too. So self-confidence got a hit. So something had to change. For a start, there was no point in hiring new Scrum Masters to fill gaps. When we look at the organization chart, it's here a Scrum Master is missing, there a Scrum Master is missing, so we should hire one. But given that teams say we can do without, and that nobody wants to change the situation, hiring would not solve the problem. As I said, there was no organizational drive to support the Scrum Master role. Not from management, and not from developers either. No developer was screaming, we want the Scrum Master in our team. So, looking at all that, from the perspective of Scrum Masters, the situation was likely to get worse rather than better, given where we were. And selecting some standard solution would not help us. It could, let's say, theorize about we should go less, we should go safe, but if nobody is very interested in changing the current situation, because only the Scrum Masters saw that they were in a crisis, then nobody would embrace something that we would come up with. Good. Out of the crisis. Scrum Masters together, those remaining, which were not that many, first focused on consolidating their own position within their teams. Make sure that you do your work well. Make sure that your team appreciates that you are with them. The second step was a reinvigoration of the Scrum Master team, because working together had taken a hit too. We were not operating as a team, we were a bundle of individuals with opinions. Third, we worked on developing our skills. We set up a skill matrix for each of us, found out where some people were good at, other people were not good at, and systematically began to teach each other. Those that are good need those that are lacking knowledge or something. Then we looked for principles over solutions. So don't think in terms of, let's say, a Scrum framework, a solution, and say, in this team, this or that is missing. Say, well, what are we trying to accomplish here? We are trying to inspect our development processes, come to conclusions about it and adapt. Is this what we need? If not, we don't need a retrospective or something like that. So think in terms of principles. Then experiment, observe and adapt. So the little steps that we were taking, because nothing was really asked of us, we tried to get out of our corner and try to do something, observe it, what is the result, and act on that result. So, I already mentioned that for the reinvigoration of the Scrum Master team, we started to systematically learn from each other. The second change was to open the Scrum Master community of practice. For quite some time, only Scrum Masters were talking with each other. Now we opened up our community of practice to a few people who were acting as Scrum Masters while officially being QAs, one a developer. So we widened our circle, we widened our reach in the organization. Second is we invited guests to our meetings. This is something we didn't do before. We invited guests because they had something to say to us, something that we might learn from, or because we were taking some initiative that they might learn from. One example is that we have a business analyst working on Jira applications. We could learn some new things from her, but she could also learn about the things that we were doing. And then last, we tried to plan our initiatives in terms of objectives and key results. So we stepped away from starting an initiative and then see, well, what happens. We planned in advance for results. So not just have an objective and an action plan, but focus on getting some change, this key result. Actually, this was very hard to do. It is answering the question, what good does a Scrum Master do? How do we measure the impact of having a Scrum Master? And this is a question that I have never heard really good answers on. But trying to answer this question really focused our thought, it made us sharper. So, where did we get by blending together and trying to operate more as a team and coming up with certain new initiatives? Well, first, we got a stronger community of practice. Second, we improved our reasoning on creating change. We were more focused on effects. Third, by inviting people, reaching out more, we got better relations with the people that we were actually, let's say, engaging. As part of the organization. So those are positive things. But while having more self-direction, we are still relatively loosely coupled with the rest of the organization. Think back of the diagrams that I showed in the beginning. It is the teams that are connected through product owners and the director of product to our whole roadmap, to our portfolio. Well, Scrum Masters are connected to teams and to other Scrum Masters. So, how to continue, how to make a next step? Well, this was not in our hands. Is anybody here, let's say, a C-level manager, chief of something, chief technology officer, something like that? But these are the people you don't see so often, but if they want something, then they really want it. It means that the organization has to satisfy their demands. So, there we have it. We had the demand to provide transparency on mid-term planning. We had to plan 6 months ahead, which was not something we did. We had to express this planning in Jira, in numbers, estimations. And to bring it to teams, development teams had to sign off on the planning for a project. Right, so management requires something. What was our reaction to that? Well, from Scrum Master, very exaggerated all this, came the idea, well, it seems to us that management wants to go back to fixed time, fixed scope, fixed number of people working, and basically taking away the freedom of teams to self-organize. So Scrum Masters were not that enthusiastic. Product owners. Product owners reacted as, we are too busy with our projects to be disturbed. Or saying, well, planning just in time works, trust us. Or say, why spend time on estimations? They won't make us work faster. Management perspective is, we must reason in terms of investment and return. We will not hire 20 more people if we don't know what they will do in 3 months. And does this development organization really know what it is doing? And you're talking about all these different things like story points and estimations in time and Kanban and Scrum. Can't you standardize so we can understand what you're doing? Don't pay too much attention to this. We had to satisfy, let's say, the requirement of transparency of management. And where we came to an agreement is patching something together from Jira and Confluence. Confluence is a wiki. Jira is, let's say, a glorified bug tracking system. And this worked in several directions. Parts of wikis ended up in a dashboard in Jira. Dashboard in Jira was referred to by a different wiki page. Things were accessible, but not very elegant. So where did we get with this clutch of Jira and Confluence to present what planning we had done and what the progress we were making on projects? Well, we got an overview of team compositions, which is something we didn't have. We got standardized dashboards per team.
we got to an overview of progress on different projects per team. This was all positive. As for drawbacks, aggregated data for story points and for subtasks, both used intensively or used in different teams, was quite messy. And the whole system was very hard to maintain. Many GR filters, wiki data, all maintained manually. Too much was changing to, let's say, keep it up to date. Then there were no extrapolations, meaning if you're halfway in the project, then you might want to say, oh, when do we think that we can be ready with this product, given our current velocity, given how much work we have done so far? So that kind of data was not presented in our clutch system. Still, we got something. We got something that wasn't there before. Now, I already told you I'm a philosopher, a developer, and a Scrum Master. As a developer, I know what a data structure is, so that's why the word turns up here. We got a data structure that encompassed all projects as a result of, let's say, our clutch system. We got metadata on each project, because all projects were issues or tasks in Jira. And we got a query linked to each project that listed all issues part of that project. This is a bit technical. Who can follow this? Two. Okay. This is not made for you to read. This is a graphical representation of our roadmap. Think of a Gantt chart. The horizontal rows are quarters. The little blocks are all projects. Different colors, different teams. This is a piece of our roadmap, not a full part, it is wider, of 2 years ago. 2 years ago, it was much smaller than it is today. Here you see that we're working with a number of teams on, well, say, 15, 20 projects at the same time. Pretty much a nightmare to keep track of. Actually, this diagram is maintained manually, which means that a product owner has the responsibility to redraw a block if a project takes longer. We are not ready yet, so this graphical representation of the block is probably a bit longer. What we got here as a result of satisfying management and transparency was that we could link this diagram to a representation of the project in Jira. So, in a way, suddenly we had all data on our portfolio together, but in a way hidden in Jira. It was there, but it was not visible so elegantly. So for showing this data is there, not visible so elegantly, we had this Jira Confluence or Jira Wiki clutch that I talked about. I tried to find a better way and generated spreadsheets. Spreadsheets with specific data that would help us, for instance, come up with the velocity of projects. Spreadsheets turned out to be a help. I find them hard to read and I couldn't generate diagrams from them. So this was a dead end. Next came using the data to generate HTML pages, which are easy to read, easy to generate, and diagrams could be generated too. Again, I'm a programmer. I created these reports. cannot see progress of this roadmap. In the eyes of management, we have a graphical thing. It's nice that you can draw it, but what is really happening? They wanted to see that. The previous attempt to make it visible was satisfactory to them, but not so satisfactory to us. And I say this because, as I said, there were some drawbacks, no extrapolations, when do we think something is ready, what is our current velocity, so we were still missing all that. So, this arrow here presents an application we created to get all this data that was waiting there in Jira to be explored out into, let's say, a single set of HTML pages with a full report on progress of all projects that we were doing. That included reporting of charts for the automatically release burnout chart, velocity chart, estimated compared to time spent, which gave us insights into each and every project. Formerly, such data could only be gotten by asking people for it. And then they said, yes, in our specific situation, I can get you something, but we are using Kanban, or we are using subtasks, or we are using time, so it takes some, let's say, specialized manual work to give a representation of the data. Now, all is done standardly. This doesn't tell you so much, but it is, let's say, progress of a project. How many of the issues have we done so far? How much time do we expect still to need to finish this project? What kind of estimation has been done to plan this project? In this case, story points. Now, reports, what are they good for? Who are they serving? This is not posting a report to management. We are not just satisfying a management requirement, please send us a report because we ask for it and you just have to do it. In a way, they are like a barometer, like a thermometer. They are just generated, they are just out there. They are not even, let's say, corrected, because there is no manual work to make them look a bit better. They may even be faulty, because the data in Jira may be represented correctly, but in reality, there may be knowledge that says, no, this is not where we are. Example. Reports may say this project is finished for 60%, but the product owner may know, no, we are finished for 90%, because a lot of these issues can be done later. They are not part of the deployment, we just keep them in our backlog because at some point we may want to pick them up. So, the reports are just out there. They are not massaged, they are not, let's say, improved, they are not made such that you think, well, management will be happier if they see the good numbers rather than the numbers that represent what is in Jira. So everybody can do with them what they want. So again, they are just a reflection of our processes, of our people, and of our products. Nobody is in between what is visible and what is in Jira. This has a huge effect. One thing is, the reports may really be quite faulty. And what we do there is fix the reports or fix the data. when I say fix the reports, I say fix the algorithm with which they are made. So we become focused on, I should go back on this one. We become focused on getting better algorithms to present our data rather than fixing individual reports. As I said, the reports are not there just to satisfy a request requirement from management. They have an effect on us by just being there. We can do something with them. Now, where they fit in our agile way of working is that we did not try to change our organization or our processes. We did not try to get people off Kanban back to Scrum. We did not try to get people off story points into estimations in time. We started with what we were doing now. So all these teams with their differences, they are allowed to have their differences. So from those differences, we can still agree to pursue incremental evolutionary change. It leaves the responsibility to change something with teams themselves. Nobody is asking them to do it, but if the results of their work are not good, then somebody will ask them to get to better results. So we respect current processes, roles, responsibilities, and titles. Reports create no change, they create questions, or they create, let's say, an indication of problems. And then together you can see that you solve them. Then this way of working encourages acts of leadership at all levels. Again, I'm just taking it from David Anderson as a role here, but everybody can do something with having the data available. This is not a report going out to management, it's a report that is available to developers too. What do you think that it is? So, for scaling, we got to a unified representation of progress on our entire roadmap. So we came to a kind of scaling through software rather than scaling through looking at the organization or standardization. I already presented you what initial reactions of Scrum Masters, product owners, and management were to having 6 months of planning ahead. So with this reporting, suddenly all kinds of data became available that was earlier obscured. So a reaction is, if management sees the raw data, it might overreact. So maybe we should not show this to them. Another is, well, if we become so precise about estimations and planning, if we do such extrapolations that give us an idea of when we can be ready, aren't we going to be drawn back into a waterfall mode of development? From a Scrum Master perspective, there is the fear. If we are working in this way with a focus on release dates, aren't we going to be project management managers instead of Scrum Masters? There are a couple of outcomes of this report. One is that we got Scrum Master involvement back in all teams. Because suddenly we can see one outcome through these reports of what all teams are progressing on. If things are not going right, if those diagrams show something that is indicating that there is something wrong in the process of a team, we have a good reason to talk with that team. So rather than having a team be rather obscure in what it is doing, talking with people is the only way to see how they are doing, we have some other indication and something to talk with. And that made it easier for Scrum Masters to get involved with teams with which they were not working on a daily basis. Second, we have feedback on planning. Because in our initial clutch, we had a presentation on a lot of data, but we did not really see feedback on planning in the way of, hey, this is what we estimated, and these are the outcomes. Now we can see this quite clearly, and again, this is something that gives us something to talk about between teams, product owners, or Scrum Masters. And third, management is quite happy about increased transparency. One thing that does for us is that they will be off our backs for some time. All this is quite fresh, and I don't doubt that some other things will turn up as a result of where we got now, but I don't know that yet. The future is uncertain on that. As I said, this is a specific situation in our company. This is an account of a journey within Evolution Gaming, and I hope you found something in it. This is the end. Thank you.